let's have a huge round of applause for Andrea and Molly, and we'll get started.
Thank you, Lynette. Hi, everybody. Thank you guys for coming. It's going to be super awesome today, and I'm going to have to work very hard to actually concentrate on drawing, because this is going to be happening right here, and it's rather mesmerizing. But the idea is I want to do a little demoing for you guys, and this is Molly Hogan, who works with me and Gnomon, and the students at Gnomon, for the zoological studies class that we do here. And she brings all kinds of critters, but today she has brought raptors for you guys. And so we're going to just do a little, like, chat while I do a little sketching. She's going to bring several birds out, and the idea is for you guys to learn a little bit about these birds. And Molly will talk a little bit about herself and her organization, just to kind of set you up for understanding what she does and her knowledge of these animals. And I'll sketch, and then I'll talk a little bit while we go about the idea of live gesture sketching as an important early tool in 2D or 3D development, whether traditional or digital. I'm not really a Photoshop artist, so I've set Photoshop up here as, like, pretend sketchbook. So I'm not allowed to use an eraser. When I sketch, I use pen only. So there's no erasing happening. There's only going to be just loose, live sketching with the pen tool that a couple of Gnomon folks helped me set up so that it's, like, sort of as close as possible to the pen that I use, which I actually really recommend for live gesture sketching, is the Pentel Fuda brush pen, the one that has the exchangeable cartridge, because you can get really dynamic form, and that's, I think, really critical, especially for an animal like a bird, which sits very quietly and then becomes really dynamic. So you want to kind of be able to move back and forth. So I'm going to let Molly talk a little bit about herself and her organization that she runs and started and spearheads, and then we'll chat a little about this fine gentleman right here. Molly.
Hey, it's great to be here today. Thanks for having us. I brought a variety of birds for you to meet, so I'm excited to show them to all of you. And I love coming here and watching my birds be reproduced on the screen here. It's very exciting. I founded the organization, which is called the Nature of Wild Works, in 1993. Because I was an animal keeper at the Los Angeles Zoo for many years, and a show that I did there called Wild in the City was canceled suddenly, and the animals didn't have any place to go. So I took them home. And it started with two mountain lions, and it ended up now with about 50 animals that we have, and we have a lot of birds of prey. So we're a nonprofit organization, and we do programs, outreach programs. This is one of the schools that we go to, where we have live animal models. But mostly we go to school groups, and we work a lot for the Park Service, teaching people about local wildlife. So this is the smallest falcon in North America. And it's called the American Kestrel, and his name is Fidel Kestrel. Can't get a better name than that.
Nope.
And he's about 4 years old now. You can see that the falcons have these pointy wings, and this helps this species to hover over its food, and it likes to eat lizards and mice and insects primarily. It's a diurnal bird of prey. That's why they have these black marks under their eyes. You can see those? It's kind of like football players, or sports people that are trying to keep the glare out of their eyes when they're playing. Well, that's the reason for that. They have absolutely amazing eyesight. And these falcons have very big eyes, so they can see their prey on the ground. And most, you know, animals, birds that fly in the air have excellent eyesight because they have to see long distances.
So Molly has brought Fidel. There's several Fidels that come to Gnomon. And they're super personable. Kestrels are super personable. And that kind of also makes them engaging and interesting to draw just from, like, an aesthetic perspective. When you're drawing live animals, you know, it's not something that's happening in your mind. What you're doing is you're using as much power of observation as you can so that later on you can use what's in your mind. It's, again, sort of building up a tool for your toolbox, which I like to call your mental toolbox, so that, you know, the engagement that this bird has is part of what makes it thrilling to note. It's not just, you know, it's something that I tell my students a lot. It's not just something that you sort of look up on the internet, and you don't just Google bird and then you just draw that. This guy is very particular. There's a very particular, you know, dynamic quality. There's also a very particular shape language happening that later on, if I were doing another drawing, if I were designing a creature, if I were doing a sculpt, you know, and I was thinking, I want to create something that is super quick, super small, super energetic, super dynamic, I'm going to think about the shape of the wing that I remember. I'm going to think about the shape of the body and know whether or not I have the live animal in front of me. And that musculature, too, is really great along his back. And be able to remember and utilize that, because that's going to have a very particular read that's quite different from if I were, say, doing an owl or some kind of massive eagle or some bird that's not a raptor. This, of course, is a bird of prey. We call them a raptor. This one particularly, like Molly said, a falcon, the smallest falcon. We've got other birds of prey, owls and butios, who are hawks, bigger, much bulkier birds. And they have a very different wing shape as well. So Fidel... Oh, also, can you talk a little bit about the coloration? Not just this, but like the overall bird coloration and how it changes. And
yeah, so this is a male. And in this species, the females and the males look different. They have different coloring. So he has, I have two kestrels, and my other kestrel has a solid blue head, or bluish-gray head, and these bluish-gray wings. And this guy has a red circle on the top of his head. And the females are quite a bit more brown and mottled looking, and the females are bigger than the males. But this time of year, after they've just molted in the summer, they're very, very dull in color because not much goes on in the fall. In the spring, their colors are so much brighter. It's just amazing. So they are really good at camouflaging right now. And then in the spring, they want to stand out. So they're very brightly colored.
Scoot your mic closer. Thanks.
Oops, that's off my
ear.
There
we go.
And... So he looks a lot different right now than he will come springtime when he's looking for a mate. And that's why their coloring changes. Even his talons, his feet, they're bright orange. And the sear right here where his nostrils are, that's bright orange as well. And so the females and the males look different in these birds, but in the other two birds you're going to see, they look exactly the same except for the size, almost exactly the same.
I can't even. He's so cute. I told you I was going to have to concentrate really hard because I'm overwhelmed by bird cuteness. And, you know, there's something else to be said about drawing the live gesture as well, is that, you know, Molly's moving her gloves so that he will kind of hop up and down and open his wings up for you a little bit, but they don't just sit there and do nothing, right? Even though the shape of the bird is, you know, rather, you could argue that it's fairly simplistic. Okay, fine. There you go. But, and that actually tells me this is a bird of prey, right? It's a bird meant for speed. Fine. That initial read is fairly simple. But there's so much more that goes on in what you think is a simple form. And that's, again, part of what I think becomes really critical in putting the tool of the live drawing in your toolbox, which is remembering it's not just that shape. But, like, for example, if I'm going to look at his cute head, he's going for her thumb. He's getting annoyed.
So stop moving around.
Right. You know, a bird of prey, I'm going to always remember from having noted, observed closely, that there is, like, a sort of shadow, the zygomas and the temporal arch right here, right? Kind of creates a brow that shades the bird's eyes from the sun. To allow for better sight, for hunting. You know, the sear, Molly was mentioning, right here, where the nostrils are, the nares, changes color. It also is going to have a particular shape. This one is fairly narrow, right? Oh, thank you. And then the beak, this is the critical thing. His beak is going to look different from the other birds' beaks, even though the other birds that we have here are birds of prey, right? Because they are all adapted to very particular eating habits. So I want to observe as carefully as I can and note not just that it is a triangle. That might be your sort of initial mental shape, but it's more about the contours of, yeah, thank you, of what's actually going on in there, and how long the mandible is, how angled the maxilla is, like I said, how narrow the sear is right here, and all those elements will come together so that my experience in drawing the live animal at some point, again, if I'm going to do a creature or if I'm going to essentially, you know, not have a kestrel directly in front of me, you know, I mean, around here, we have them all the time. Yeah. You just got to come to Gnomon. Got them all the time. But, you know, I need to know what that is. And I think that really being attentive to the elements of the bird allows for a dynamic read later on in whatever we would want to utilize those shapes for. Do you want to switch them out?
Okay, sure.
Okay, we're going to switch birds. And I'm going to see if I can remember what's going on here. So those primaries, the long flight feathers, right? Very long and narrow. The secondaries, also fairly long. And then the feathers that are on the wing, like the top part of the wing, the shoulder, we would call, those are the coverts. And those are the ones that lie really flat and kind of tight to create a foil, an aerodynamic foil. And then you guys could see, even on a teensy-weens bird, that the musculature along the back is really pronounced. Because that is a bird that hovers and dives, so there's a lot of weight and power that comes. Oh, this is Dancer. I will let you talk about Dancer.
So Dancer is a barn owl, and barn owls are hugely common, almost worldwide. They're very, very successful birds. And I love holding the kestrel and this barn owl because they weigh almost nothing. This bird actually weighs half of a pound. So I can stand here all day just holding it, and it seems like I'm very strong. But they're very, very lightweight because they're covered with very soft, lightweight feathers. And, of course, birds have hollow bones, and this makes them able to fly like they do. Now, they have silent flight. So where you could hear the kestrel wings, and with the next bird you'll really be able to hear her wings, you can't hear them flying at all. And that's how they sneak up on their food, which is primarily mice. One barn owl that weighs one half of a pound can eat 1,000 mice a year. So they are great rodent control. Dancer's 10, and Dancer fell out of the nest in Beverly Hills when she was a chick. And she was rescued by the homeowners and brought over to us. And so she is what we call imprinted on people. So she thinks that she is a person or that I am a barn owl. Not sure which one. But she's too used to being around people and being close up. See how calm she is? And you would never see an owl just sitting calmly by you like this. Now, owls cannot turn their head all the way around. But they can turn it 270 degrees. And, of course, 360 is all the way around. And that's how they see all around them, because they cannot move their eyes in the sockets like we do. They can't move their eyes back and forth, so they have to turn their head to see. So when she turns her head, it'll look like her head's on backwards. So it's quite impressive. But I want to show you something funny. This is, she kind of likes this. She goes, okay, you can pet me. But it shows you how her skull is so tiny under here. You know, with all the feathers. And here are her ears. I don't know if you can see them or not, but they're holes in the head, and they're asymmetrical. So one's here and one's here. And that helps them to pinpoint the sound. But, you know, you can see that there's her neck all the way in there. So it's just primarily feathers.
What a good girl she is.
I know, she's great.
She's the best girl. And so, again, very different from Fidel, who we just had, not only in, well, obviously it's a different kind of bird, but in the shape of the body, in the details of the body, and even in the wings. So would you mind shaking her one more time? Thanks. So if you look at the shape of her wings, they're much more rounded, right? Her feathers are shaped completely differently. And in fact, like the little sketch I did right here, you'd think that if you thought about what we just saw with Fidel, those primaries are very straight and sharp, right? And they're also set into the wing in a particular way. If you look at dancers, those primaries are curved, and then the secondaries actually are curved in the opposite direction. And that's something that you don't want to just ignore and be like, well, when I draw a bird, it just, the wing looks like a bird wing. Because, of course, there's an aerodynamic reason for that. There's a flighted reason for that. So that would be another tool that you would kind of put in your toolbox, knowing if you are drawing an owl, like her, that those feathers are going to be set into the wing a particular way. And then the same goes for the patterning. So if you want to talk about her feather patterns.
Yeah, it's very rarely that you see the back of a barn owl. And this coloration helps them to blend in like you wouldn't believe, to camouflage. And, you know, when you look at her up close like this, you say, wow, she can't hide at all out in nature. It's so obvious. But when she's sleeping in her house, she lives in an aviary type setup with a little den box, a little house, a barn for her. And she sits there like this and closes her wings like this when she sleeps. And then she puts her head down and moves the feathers in on her face and holds perfectly still. And you can't see her. You can't see her. You have to, you know, we see movement. We're predators too, just like these guys. So they hold so still, and that's how, of course, they defend themselves to animals like the great horned owl that can kill a barn owl at night. But if they just hold perfectly still, it's hard for anybody to see them. And so this breaks up the pattern of their body, these spots. Like, you know, a lot of cats will have spots. And in the filtered light through the leaves on the trees, you just can't see them at all. And that is when they sleep, of course, during the day. They're nocturnal animals, so they're up at night. And they don't hoot. They're not the animals that hoot. I'm going to do this bad imitation of what they sound like. Okay, ready? That's on film. Okay.
Great.
Right.
She's like, oh, Mom, you're so embarrassing.
Well, you can do it, and then I won't have to.
Right?
But the great horned owls, you know, the bigger brown owls with the giant yellow eyes, they go, hoo, 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 hoo. And those are the serious predators, tigers of the night, that catch house cats and skunks and things. But this bird is so lightweight that it's great to have them around the house to keep down the mice. Are you going to turn your head around today? She goes, you guys are so interesting. I don't want to look behind me.
I know, right? But she does like to look up there. There's plenty
they
of
always
interesting things
go.
Up there.
Yeah, they always want to go to the highest point.
Right.
And she likes it because it's nice and dark in here. So she goes, my time of day.
So again, the detailing will include what Molly was just talking about, and then knowing sort of very particularly, remembering in my wrist and in my mind what that radio dish, essentially, of a face is like. It's not just that it's, you know, a charming heart shape, which is cute, but it's more that there's a particular planar quality to it, an angular quality to it. And that's for a reason, right? We're talking about not just the gesture and the energetic quality of the live animal, but we're talking about why the anatomy is the way that it is. And the more sort of observation and seeing and attention that you're paying to those things, it's like, look at where the feathers come out and how they radiate, right, to create that radio dish so that she can hear Molly's heartbeat. Which is pretty great.
That's right. Their hearing is they have the best hearing of anybody. They can hear your heart beating if you're sitting this close to them. So it's kind of amazing how she must tune out all the human noise. But they do like to stay far away from people because they like to live in the tops of palm trees here. Since we don't have barns for them in California, that's where they like to nest, in the tops of palm trees, because they don't build their own nests. But you can always see owl castings on the ground because they regurgitate pellets. From the prey that they eat. They can't digest the bones and feathers. So that's one way you can tell that an owl lives up in the tree.
Okay. And you want to bring Queen out?
Yep.
We got one more for you guys.
Last but not least.
She is the lady with the most attitude of all of the raptors here today.
She says, I don't want to go back.
You can see, as she just put her away, you could see her beautiful barred wings, right? That's something else, again, with looking at the live animal, or, for example, you go to the Natural History Museum, which I highly recommend, and which you would do if you came and took zoological, and paying attention, again, to the detailing of what feather is going to look like what for what purpose, right? You don't just sort of arbitrarily craft that. And you can see here an entirely different bird with an entirely different set of feathers. Oh, queen.
Miss Personality.
She's probably going to try to poop at me.
Yeah, she will.
Very deliberately. What a jerk.
So this is Queen. We named her Queen for obvious reasons. Queen is a female Harris's hawk. And these birds don't live here in California, but they're very, very popular in the sport of falconry. They are from the Southwest, from Arizona and Texas, and they like to hunt cooperatively, which means they hunt like wolves. You know, they get together with their buddies, and they decide to kill a giant jackrabbit so they can kill larger prey if they talk about it and devise a plan. So that makes them sort of like parrots. So this bird is kind of more needy than the other species. She complains a lot about whatever, and so she talks a lot, and you see she's really curious, she's looking around. And you can see I have a female and a male, Harris hawk, and the male is significantly smaller than this. They're supposedly, the females are a third larger, but I'd say he's half the size of her. She's complaining right now, if you can hear her. I don't know if you can hear her. She's going, where's my dead mice? And that's what we do feed her, is rats, mice, chicks, and quail. And she is very fat right now, because and she hasn't been handled much, because in the summer we feed them up and we let them molt, which means they replace their feathers. And then right about now I start flying them again for our classes, so then I have to cut them back on some food. So that's why she's complaining, she hasn't had as much food as normal. Here's her tail. She has the white tip on the feathers, and she has the big wings, giant wings. There she
is. Can you guys hear her?
You want to speak into the microphone, Queen? She'd probably eat the microphone if I put it up there.
Right.
But they have extremely long legs, and they like to sit on the top of the saguaro cactus and look for their giant jackrabbits. And they do something really interesting. It's called stacking, where they sit on top of each other. So they make a little hawk pyramid. And I don't know how they decide who's on the bottom. I guess the dominant one would be on the top, right? But anyway, they're very, very interesting. And, yeah, your turn.
She's so fun. She's so irritated by everything, always. Whenever she comes to Gnomon, she's always like, these people again. And Prince, the other Harris, is very friendly. And the last time we brought them both in together, you could definitely tell Queen was telling Prince to shut up the whole time and not be so nice to everybody.
You can pretty get much, yeah. That's pretty much true.
Right? And I mean, you know, like we were saying, her brow is shadowed so that she can have her eyesight protected from the sun while she's hunting. But with her personality, and she's kind of like this all the time, and actually how her body, like her center of gravity and how her body is set, she just always looks kind of bent, which is really appealing visually. But especially with her, you guys can see her talons are enormous. Really huge, really powerful. And again, as with all elements of sort of looking at the particulars of who you're drawing and why, you want to see that in the shape of the beak, the head, the overall shape of the body, and with the feet, that indicates habitat and it indicates feeding, right? So she's got quite powerful talons.
Sorry.
And I also want to say something real quick just about like how I'm working up here, which is how I draw and actually how I work with the students in terms of drawing. And it's not to really be too precious about what you're putting down on the paper because, well, for one, the animal doesn't really care at all. And you really shouldn't either. This is an exercise. It's an exercise in seeing and developing that skill in seeing. It's in being able to look quickly back and forth and to not really worry quite so much about the perfection of the information that you're putting down, because what I'm doing is more training my hand to be able to do this some other time, right, or when it's necessary, so that I'm looking at, you know, the arch of her shoulders and how high up they kind of rise and the way her back dips, so that at some point, if I needed to, I could do it without her being in front of me, and know that I'm looking in my mind's eye at her instead of the barn owl, or instead of an eagle owl, or bald eagle, or any other animal, right? So the drawing, the making a mess, like I like to tell my students, that it's okay to make a mess, in fact it's a good thing, is because it's indicating to me that my mind is working and my wrist is working, rather than second guessing what the visual information is. The information's right in front of me, right? And the live gesture is part of what allows you to build that tool, rather than make an assumption. The information is all right here. I know. Yes, you. Let's see. So, the other thing I just want to point out real quick, and this is something that I also talk to the students about here in this class, is it's kind of a waste of time to be hampered by doing this and doing this. I mean, it already looks like crap, right? And that's because there's no circle in that bird, except maybe her pupil. There's contours, there's forms, there's how the light is, the form is receiving the light. There's shape language, but there aren't shapes. And I think some of our other folks this afternoon demoing are going to talk a little bit more about, in terms of sculpting, you know, how you perceive shape and how you sculpt with light and form. But in doing shape building, I want you artists out there to think more about what it actually is that's in front of you, rather than your assumption that the head is a circle, because you guys all are looking at the bird right now. She's attempting to freedom, and you can see that her head is not a circle at all. You bad girl. And that's also part of being okay with making a mess. It's okay that the gesture drawing is not perfect, that it overlaps on itself, that, you know, I'm moving from one piece of information to the next as quick as I can, and often that's because the bird will change position anyways. So I just have to roll with it. Yes, you. Molly, anything more you want to say about your organization?
It's been really fun to have a wildlife center for 23 years. I've learned so much about animals, that's just unbelievable. And one thing that happens when you have your own wildlife center is that you're there 24 hours a day. So you get to know the animals at all different times of day. And we also see them attract other animals from the wild. You know, we've seen bobcats and coyotes and owls especially come around to say hi, gray foxes. I even saw a red fox once. And so I just feel very, very fortunate to be in this line of work. And animals are my passion, obviously. And I've just had this great opportunity and a great opportunity to share the animals with all of you. So we'll enjoy showing you the birds, all the birds that we brought today.
And if you guys take our zoological class here, we spend more time with Molly and with other live animals as well. And I think it's a really wonderful thing that we get to do at Gnomon, and that's being able to utilize live animals in study, no matter what track or path you follow as a visual artist or a designer. And we also are super lucky here in Los Angeles because we have the zoo. There's a couple of zoos, but we also have the Natural History Museum. And our Natural History Museum is awesome. And we are also super privileged today to have Natural History Museum folks here who are going to come up next and talk to you guys about a different way of looking at animals still rooted in the same ideas, but and that's Alice Markham and Tim Bovard. And Tim is the head taxidermist? Sure. The taxidermy master, I'm going to just say that, at the Natural History Museum of Los Angeles County. And his colleague, Alice Markham, who also works at the museum, is the owner of Prey Taxidermy. And these guys have some quite extraordinary things. They're going to take this to the next level. And I'm going to minimize my Photoshop and have them come up. And we're going to put Queen away. And thank you so much, Molly. Thanks, guys.
Thank you so much, Andrea and Molly.
That was amazing. Thank you, everyone.
We're just going to have a couple of minutes change over here. So we'll put the live beds away, and we're going to bring out some taxidermy examples as well on the stage. For those of you here, I know it's kind of hard to see some of the birds up close. So when we have our intermission, we'll also be having all five birds back out, probably individually, I think, and we'll be able to do some sketching. And as well, like, we've been getting some pretty cool, like, close-ups on the cameras, so you can watch this event again when you get back home. It's livestream.com/Gnomon, and you can find that there. Definitely recommend watching it again.
On there, and we could put the birds on the
Let's
end
do that.
It.
All right. So, thank you guys. Thank you, Gnomon, so much for having us. I appreciate it. Again, I'm Alice Markham. I'm the owner of Prey Taxidermy. And I have worked at the Natural History Museum, but I started Prey. And of course, though, still at the Natural History, we have my mentor, Tim Bovard. And Tim, I'm going to let you kick it off. And I'm going to go ahead and run the slideshow a little bit from here. Sound good?
Yes. I am more old school. So my comfort factor is here, not so much there. I'll just tell you that. Luckily for me, Alice's comfort factor is across the board. One of the biggest good things that happened to me in my 32 years at the Natural History Museum is in 2011, Alice walked in the door. Actually, she sort of stalked me on the internet first.
I definitely stalked him on the internet.
Anyways, came in for an interview, volunteered for me, worked for me for a couple of years on a couple of projects where I needed extra help. Anyways, great person, and she learned a lot very quickly. The thing about specimens is, and this is something that not everybody who's worked with me really, some of them end up doing model making rather than working with a real skin, because when you're working with a real skin, you're working with something that's fragile. You may only have one of it. You can't just do anything. There's restrictions and ways you have to work with things. Alice picked up on that very quickly when she first got to me. She was actually really thought mammals were going to be her thing, and pretty soon she was working on birds, and as you'll see, she really learned how to do birds very well. So,
oh, tell me more about myself.
The shot you see is up in my studio in the fourth floor at the Natural History Museum. Behind us are death masks. So one of the things going back all through time for any taxidermist, including me, but going some of these death masks you see on the wall there date from the teens and the 1920s. Okay, early days of taxidermy at the Natural History Museum. Those are reference casts because every little bit that a taxidermist can collect from reference, death mask, measurements will help us to finally get something that's finished. The couple of birds I'm going to be fooling with this later while Alice is talking about birds, these are not done. These are still, I can do anything pretty much, especially with this peregrine I just put together yesterday. So it's all floppy and loose, and so now is when I can make it look like a peregrine, not just a stuffed bird.
Can we go into the history?
Yeah. So Carl Akeley, long history of really good taxidermy in North America. Carl Akeley was a famous taxidermist, at least for taxidermists. Taxidermists generally aren't famous. You see them on TV, right? And they're usually not depicted, or in the movies, not necessarily depicted well, but Carl was a really fine taxidermist at the turn of the last century. And there's actually the Akeley Hall at the American Museum that he's famous for starting, and he was one of the early taxidermists to try and do habitat work, which is my favorite way to do taxidermy, meaning building a whole diorama to create a whole scene around a particular animal or group of animals. Another person who worked at our museum, actually, is George Adams. This is a picture of George working on a moa, which is a bird from New Zealand that's extinct now. When he was at the American Museum, George worked on a lot of the large animals that we have and some of the smaller ones, but he was at the museum about 23 years. This is an early photo of Louis Paul Jonas, also came from worked at the American Museum in New York, but did some contract work for us. Some of the elephants, the hippos, the rhinos that you see at our museum, he worked on those. Very fine, large animal taxidermist. And what I want to then now talk to you about is sort of the process on a mammal. It's very different from what we do on a bird.
We're going into birds first.
That's birds first.
Birds first. Okay. So I'm going to kind of talk about the process of birds, and then Tim, if you're going to be working on those, can I ask you to work over here, because the camera this way will be able to see you.
I can.
Can you? So these are a couple of birds that I worked on for the Moore Lab, which is at Occidental College, and so there are local western scrub jays. Scrub jays are protected. There's a lot of laws around birds and taxidermy specimens, and specimens in general, and you guys should know that. And the way I'm able to work on these birds, just like I did at the museum, these are for an educational institution. And so, but this is the finished product, or at least when we set out to do taxidermy, we hope the finished product, you know, looks alive and has some feathers left on it. But how does this process all start? So basically, this is a lease tern. This is also at the Moore Lab. And I don't know if you guys can see, but you see down the middle, I've parted the feathers. Just like you can part your hair, birds can part their feathers. And their feathers generally grow in kind of a pattern. We call that a feather tract. So when you make your cuts, you're trying to stay away from those patterns. And you can see on this, and this is a dove. So I go through several different birds here, and you're going to have to forgive me bouncing around. This is a dove, and I've made an incision, and I've opened up that skin. And so what you're seeing here, that's the muscle. That's that breast muscle that is so strong, which is why these birds are able to fly, of course, right? And again, our presentation is not going to be a lot of blood and guts or anything like that, but it's going to be the type of gore you might see if you were in a chef's kitchen. So it's not going to be that bad. There is some. So after I've got that open, I'm going to actually remove the body. And by body, I mean the chest and the abdomen. But as you can see on this toucan, I have left in the skull with that nice big beak attached to it. There's wing bones in there and leg bones in there. But it's still looking a little gross. It's still looking a little bit, you can see a little bit of fat on it and everything. We've got to get rid of all that to make this not attractive to pests. Taxidermy is a way to preserve an animal. That's why we it's not stuffing. Stuffing is like a no-no term in the taxidermy world. We mount the animals. We don't stuff them. Although mounting animals doesn't sound great either. So.
That reminds me, I didn't bring our prop, my little stuffed animal that somebody brought back from Japan.
Tim likes to hold up like a little, literally stuffed animal. And this is a stuffed animal. This is taxidermy. So going on, cleaning that skin. This is the inside of a bird skin. This looks like, I think this is a rooster. Do you see all those little bumps? Those are the feather follicles coming through the skin. And those are normally, those follicles are surrounded by fat. So that the bird, just like we saw when you had the couple of the live birds up here, they can kind of, you know, shake all those feathers around. They move that skin almost like it's, you know, it's this free-moving kind of thing. It's not really like us. So then after that skin is cleaned, or while that's happening, you can see here I've constructed a little body. I'll actually lay that body I remove out on a piece of paper, do a simple little tracing of that, and a simple little neck. This technique is about, you know, probably a couple hundred years old or more. I teach this technique in my classes. This is how I first learned birds from Tim. And it looks great, and I still use this technique to this day. You can get more advanced with it. You can see here, this is a finished peacock. Not the best peacock, it's like the first one I did. But I did one a little more recently where I created a foam body and then I actually built up a bunch more in the legs, a more accurate neck, et cetera, et cetera. So there are some techniques in here where you get into molding, casting, carving, et cetera. And then from there, this is some glass eyes. And I'm going to pass around a couple of things at this point. And then, you know, just... if you guys want to pass these around, there's some glass eyes in this bag. And then this is a bird skin. This is a European starling. You're welcome to touch it. Just don't bend anything. And then that's a raw bird skin, but you'll see it's dried and it's cleaned and it's been washed. And then you can see the glass eyes from there. And then we wire the bird up. So this is a relatively small bird, but you can see the wires next to the bones. You can see them tied on there. You can see the little glass eyes in the head. And then the little body over there on the right. And so from there, we blow dry it. That's a different bird. You can see I did a nice foam body. That picture of the two birds you saw finished, the scrub jays, this is one of them. And then you spend a lot of time doing what Tim is doing now. Tim is posing this bird. These are birds he put together this one yesterday. And so he's got the body in there. He's got the glass eyes. But it's looking a little funky right now. So he could just sit here for, I don't know, days? No, it won't take Tim that long. He could sit here for a couple hours and get this bird to look really like one of those live ones. You'd be amazed. And it does take some time. You can see in this photo I'm working on a Cooper's hawk. And this is in the nature lab at the Natural History Museum where this guy ended up. And I'm using tweezers to position each and every little feather. So to what Andrea was speaking about earlier, like she was saying that crease along the back, seeing which way those feathers set and everything. When you're drawing it, I sit there and Tim sits there. We think about those things when we're actually grooming it. So that's kind of our thoughts as well. You can see on this guy, this is a little merlin that I did not that many, but and then you can see I've got photo reference. So I didn't have any live bird reference. You guys are very lucky. But I had a photo, and I was trying to do a pretty good match of that photo, and that's what I go for. Another example, so this is a skin of a yellowbill hornbill. This is I don't know if Madison and Jen are here today. They're two of the ladies that run the studio with me. And this is a hornbill. When it's all wired up and washed, and that's it completed. And then same thing here. This is a mot-mot. This is a South American bird. And then here it is doing a preening thing completed. And this one was by Jen, and the other one was by Madison. And so that's really what bird taxidermy is about, is thinking about behavior, anatomy, how things are going to work. And you really kind of have to have a plan, but with birds also, you really make it, sometimes I let it tell me what it wants to do. And there's Jen right there. I was showing them your bird. Jen did that. So I am going to hand it over to Tim now to talk about mammals. And maybe I get to touch that bird a little, because I just want to groom it. So, oh, yeah. And then one other thing on birds, you can kind of see with this one. This is in flight. You notice how Tim was moving these birds? Because these are still wet. He's working on these. This is dry. This, I'm not moving these wings. It is dry, dry, dry. So I'm going to hand it over to Tim. I'll throw these skins out here for you. But I'll do the thing still.
So, worked on lots of, obviously, exhibits at the Natural History Museum. I am the taxidermist, so I work on a wide range of things. I don't just do birds or mammals. I do reptiles, do fish, do amphibians, make plants, rocks, trees, whatever we need
for
the dioramas.
Quit bragging.
Anyways, for me at least, because I really like the outdoors, each part of that, people say, well, what do you like the most? It's whatever I'm currently working on. This first year peregrine that unfortunately, a falconry friend of mine, unfortunately was flying it, hit a wire, broke its wing, done. So he gave me the bird. It's in good plumage. Well, we can use it somewhere at the Natural History Museum to tell one of our stories. So at the Natural History Museum, almost always when I'm mounting something, it doesn't matter whether it's this adult full-colored female Cooper's hawk, or whether it's the Sumatran tiger you're seeing up on the screens, it's for a particular exhibit to help tell a story. Sumatran tiger up there was for an exhibit on cats, and so we had 26 species of wild cat in that exhibit, talking about how specialized cats are. Unfortunately, because of their specialization, many, many cats of the world are endangered. Whereas the dog family, not so much, because they're much more adaptable. They can eat a wider variety of things. So that part of our story about the Sumatran tiger here. Next one. So, as I said, reference is key. So here's a couple of shots of measurement sheets. The first thing I do when I get an animal in is I may take a death mask, but I'm also going to take full measurements of the face. This is for a mammal. Then on the next sheet, I'm going to take carcass measurements after I take the skin off. This one happens to be for an ungulate, a zebra. Perhaps a dactyl. But anyways, so I've got them for all kinds of different animals, carnivores, rodents. And this is my guide so that I can make an artificial body that looks realistic. Next one. So once again, my death mask. There's some hand casts up there from Chris, a gorilla that died at the LA Zoo back in the 90s. He was 31, congestive heart failure. Most of the animals I get in today's world are salvaged specimens. So they've died at the zoo, natural causes. Sometimes they've been hit by a car, flown into a window, hit a wire, that kind of thing. So I have hand casts from Chris. I also have a death mask I made of Chris. And if you go to the Natural History Museum, you'll see Chris on exhibit. And hopefully sometime in the next couple of years, I'll add another gorilla or two, because gorillas are social, and poor Chris has been all by himself since about 1998.
Good segue.
So things do have to get skinned, even big things. This is Sumatran tiger from the LA Zoo, not the one I mounted, a later one. I have that skin still. I have to take things when they're available, and so this was sort of a backup skin for the Sumatran tiger we have on exhibit, or if we decided to do a Sumatran tiger diorama, I have a skin. It's not something, the kind of stuff I work on is not something you find on a shelf. So we're in the process of taking the skin off. We've taken the facial measurements. We're going to take carcass measurements as soon as we've got the skin off. Next thing that happens with a mammal skin, different from a bird skin, unless I'm in the field. If I'm in the field with no refrigeration, then I will actually skin, flesh, and salt bird skins and bring them back salted. But generally, they're going to go into a freezer, whereas my mammal skin is going to be salted and dried and then go through a tanning process.
I don't know if we have kind of photos of that.
So next thing I've got to have is a form. So one of the things we needed for our Age of Mammals exhibit, LA exhibit, Becoming LA, that opened in 2013, was we needed a Corrientes cow. Corrientes cow are the cow that the Spanish brought over. They're small, hardy, adaptable, brought over and released in California, and they were here by the bazillions until we had, sort of like we're having now, a drought situation, and there was a cattle zoic or epizoic, and it wiped them all out. Okay, but we want to tell the story of California and LA history, and so we needed a Corrientes cow. So I was able to get a Corrientes cow. The form's out there. I would have loved to have sculpted from scratch, but I just had one to do, and to save myself time, I bought this form you see upside down on the cart. And this cart, this form is for about a 1,250 to 1,300 pound steer. My cow weighed 750 pounds. So the next shot shows I've started to cut that form down. And literally I took a sawzall to it, and I whacked 26 inches off in length and more than a foot in height, cutting the bones where the bones would be, using my skeleton, using all my reference, and then here it is put back together, now in the 750-pound range that my cow was, and then with the skin starting to go on it, and then finally with Alice and I, happy days, the cow is sewed up. Sewing something like this takes days, all right, because relatively short hair, not as short as a zebra, but still there's a lot of sewing, and Alice helped me sew that cow.
So really late nights at the museum and a lot of coffee, and I got to sew a cow butt. It was great. Very proud.
So if you go to the museum, you'll see this in our LA exhibit. And it's a domestic animal, but the process, obviously, I go through for a mammal is the same. Sometimes, in the case of that gorilla I showed you earlier, that's a complete sculpture from scratch. There's no gorillas out there on the market. And so I made a complete sculpture, sculpted the hands, sculpted the face. It's all a sculptured part. Now, let's go to the... Here, Travis will like this. So here's a really, really skinny young mountain lion that I did for our nature lab, because we were trying to illustrate what happens here, and especially in Southern California. There's not a lot of room for the lions that live here, the mountain lions. And so the males, after they get to a certain age, usually about 18 months, the female will kick them out and they're not going to hang with her anymore. The male who's in that area won't tolerate them, and so they try and find new territory. And when they do that, of course, what do they have to do? They usually have to cross highways, and this one was a roadkill. And he was, as long as some of the cats I've done that were, say, 120, 130 pounds, and he was just 90 pounds. So he was still trying to figure things out, and before he could, and that's the problem with habitat fragmentation that we talk about in our nature lab. Like I say, always a story. And here he is, finished up. Kind of a stringy guy with a big head. He's a male. Anyways, in that with a couple of skunk friends behind him there.
And then?
George Adams, as I said, was a longtime taxidermist at Ari. He's a very much of a sculptor taxidermist. When we're trying to develop our idea, especially for a diorama, often we'll do a series of miniatures to play with our design idea. What do we want? What are we going for? What do we have? What can we get? That kind of thing. We may even add plants to this original little model. And the next step, George is going through the process that I really love, but I usually, as the only taxidermist full-time, I got some great volunteers, I just don't have time to sculpt everything from scratch. And I can save myself time because there's these marketable forms out there that I can cut up and re-sculpt faster than I could do a clay sculpture over a skeleton. But when I first got there, the gorilla, like I said, is like this. So you set up a skeleton, you've got all those measurements, put some plaster on to kind of cover up and strengthen that skeleton. Clay goes over the skeleton. Once you have that clay sculpture, and so this is plasticine clay, then a mold gets taken of that, in this case plaster. Nowadays I tend to use fiberglass to make that mold. Pull that mold apart and out of that mold. And here's the final mannequin, and it shows the reinforcing because, of course, a moose in this case probably has 80 pounds of antlers on top of its head. And so that neck has to be reinforced. This is the burlap and plaster form. So going up through the early 80s when I got to the museum, we mostly were using burlap and plaster and paper mache. And then about the mid-80s, I switched over and started to use urethane foam. So here's the skin going on of that moose. The moose is on exhibit. It's glued and sewed over that form. Obviously, something this size is a lot of sewing, but moose have fairly long hair. Of course, they have very distinctive nose, dewlap, really classic. And here he is in the final group. So you saw the original sort of positions they had. In this, you've got a combination of dried grasses, artificial trees, artificial leaves, and, of course, a background painting to create that scene. We have, oh, George working on the giraffe. So this male giraffe is in the corner. Obviously, big things like this will take more space. The elephants were done actually off-site and moved on-site. Most of the stuff I work on today, I work on up in my studio, and I'm able to get them into elevators and that kind of thing to get them downstairs where we're working on. But something like a giraffe, not the case. So here's the original clay sculpture. Here's the mold. Once again, going up on it, plaster. Then that laid into that plaster is the mannequin, and this is a burlap and plaster mannequin. You can show he sort of reinforced the neck. And there he is with the skin on in the diorama. I actually did it in the diorama building because at the time our taxidermy studio was across the street. And they would not have been able to get this thing in the door at, you know, 17 feet long, basically. And so he actually put it together in the hall where it is today. Our elephants actually came in pieces, the bigger ones, and were put together in place. Here's that elephant waterhole diorama. We've modified this a couple of times since I've been there. One of the neat things about the program, one of the things why I'm the luckiest person you are going to meet today, maybe the luckiest person you're going to meet this month, is we've had an active diorama program going back to the 20s. I don't know of any other museum in North America that stayed active over that time. There's some museums like Denver, like the American Museum in New York, Milwaukee Public Museum, that have really excellent dioramas and diorama programs, but most of those stopped in the 20s, 30s, 40s, and then they just left them. In our case, we kept working on them. I'm the latest person to be the one who's there. When I first got to the museum, I had quite a team. Now I'm mostly the team myself, of course, with, luckily for me, volunteers like Alice who still like coming in and working on stuff. And, hey, it's a really cool place. If you haven't been there, I do say go by and see. Dioramas are interesting because, of course, you've got a whole dynamic with a two-dimensional background and a three-dimensional foreground, and you've got to make that blend and work together. And one of the fun things in my life is doing that. So trying to create this scene that really few feel like you could just walk right in. And most of the people, of course, who visit the museum, they're not going to get to go to all the places that I haven't even been to all the places that our dioramas depict. But for whatever reason, probably because almost all of us are familiar with the outdoors to some degree, our diorama halls have been very popular for lots of years. Some of you have been maybe to a First Friday event. No, we do special events in those diorama halls too, so they come in multi-purpose areas for us. It's a constant dynamic program. I'm adding things. This female Cooper's hawk will end up in a diorama. This first-year peregrine probably is going to end up in our bird hall. Got stuff going all the time. And now, questions?
Yeah, so we were going to do a little bit of Q&A. The other thing I was going to get passing around, if you guys want to take a closer look at things, is I got a couple of skins while we're talking, and then you can manhandle these. I am going to pass around. This is a Eurasian jay. I just ask, you may touch it. Please don't, like, bend the wings or anything, and if you touch it, just use, like, you know when you're a kid and you're like, two-finger touch. Do that, and only go with the feathers.
Alice? You want to have them do one that's almost unbreakable?
No,
still
I trust
a little
them.
Soft?
Yeah. Actually, let's do just, are you okay with us passing that around?
Yeah.
Okay. Tim's getting wild today, you guys. All right, Birdorama. Yeah, so be careful with those. But we're going to go ahead and take some questions. And Andrea, whoever, just let us know when we're up on time or... Okay, cool. Thank you so much, Lynette.
Cool. Let's have a round of applause first, because that was so awesome. So awesome. So, do we have any questions here on the stage? Yes?
Awesome. Hi, thanks, guys. I was just wondering, what led you to the path to become a taxidermist? What made you want to pursue this line of work versus any other career with animals?
Well, Tim just really hates animals. You know, he... No. No, I think we both really, really love animals. I'll let you tell your story, Tim. It's wonderful.
Yeah, I am a natural history file. It's sort of part of me from way back. As a kid, there weren't all the rehab places that there are today taking care of wild animals. It was known I liked them. So people would bring me stuff that they'd found, and because Tim would know what to do with it. And my dad was a college professor. I grew up in Claremont, California. Not a wild place, but I raised, I guess, probably half a dozen kestrels and released them, among other things, like the little, beautiful little male kestrel you saw. So I really, surprisingly enough, and all the best taxidermists I know, really like live animals. We really do. But the challenge is when, as a kid, I found that dead skunk. Gosh, skunks are beautiful. Could I make that skunk look alive again? Seemed like such a waste. Now I know biology-wise, it's going to get recycled, you know, it's going to break down, all that stuff. But seemed like a waste to me. So I took that little skunk, I took it home. My parents, luckily, very tolerant. They said, what are you going to do? I'm going to mount it. I'm going to make it look like a live skunk. I had some books. I did it. Well, it didn't look near as good as the skunks that Alice did for me. But that got me started. The process of, and for me, the fascination is, can we take this young or first-year peregrine and really make it look like a peregrine? Can we capture the illusion? Because when we're done, this is going to be a piece of jerky, right? One of the things, you know, our skin is soft, it's hydrated. It is with all these live animals as well. So we have to try and create this illusion of life that you're doing with drawings, right? Or with digital media. You're trying to create that illusion. One of my good friends who worked with me for a while, he used to bring his crews in from various movies because he knew he could look at the real thing to get a better idea of what they were going to reproduce on stage. So that fascination, and for me that fascination is, I look at leaves that way too. I look at rocks. Look at that rock. That thing's beautiful. Can I make that? And my wife's fascination is, well, you can. That's just like strange. But for me, trying to reproduce that 3D thing that I'm seeing and capture the essence of it so that when you look at it, you just think, oh, those are just real leaves. They just dried them and stuck them in there. No. Okay, but if that illusion is there, then I'm being successful. And the same with the birds we may work on. The fun thing for me is people like Alice have come in and sort of found me or whatever, or when we're teaching a class together at Prey Taxidermy, that fascination is there, right? Some of you out there may have that fascination. I know Travis has that fascination. There's that animal. Can we make it look real again? Can we capture that vitality? And it's not an easy thing because there's a lot of detail there. And it's easy to get sort of buried in the detail and not sort of the overall of what that animal is. So it's fascinating.
Yeah. My story is pretty much exactly what he said. For him only, maybe I wouldn't have said it as well. So, but yeah, no, for me it's both an art and a science. And I came to this career after I worked in marketing on like the digital side. And I just really wanted to work with my hands again in some way or create something that was kind of truly creative. But I also, you know, I truly love science. And I was feeling a bit lost at that time in my life and ended up taking some taxidermy courses in Montana, got back, had no idea what to do with it, stalked Tim, and was able to really, I mean, the Natural History Museum to me always felt like hallowed ground. You know, always from the time I was a kid, any museum to living in New York and the American Museum there. And I'm a bit of an engineer in my head and I want to know how things are made. And then I really just fell in love with the nuances of it and then the passion of the people that I get to work with. Because not just working with Tim, but working with, you get to work with ornithologists, you get to work with biologists, you get to learn about these animals from wonderful people like Molly. I mean, I learned so much during her talk as well, because I'm so fascinated by birds. And, you know, so it's really, really fantastic to learn. So it's just that passion. Other questions? Yes. Oh, there's a microphone going around. I forgot.
Hi. Hi, can you hear me? Thanks. So basically, I just kind of had a more technical question. When you guys receive some of these larger animals, obviously they're going to undergo some sort of rigor mortis. And how fast do you guys have to work to get these skins off and preserve them? Or what's that process like all the way up until the point when after you got it all off and you're ready to cast?
Yeah, so the question is basically how fast do we have to work on something before it starts rotting? I mean, the simple answer to that is, like, if you go to your refrigerator, you can tell when something smells funky, it's not going to be any good. It's the same for us with taxidermy. Once that animal starts breaking down, you're going to have problems. Typically speaking, when we work on something, we hope that it got into the freezer fast enough. But if it didn't, sometimes we've got to do what we have to do. Do you want to talk about Chris the gorilla?
Yeah, each specimen is different. Some things are really, really prone to having issues. Primates are one of those, right? Especially captive primates are really prone to start losing skin, start losing hair. A lot of the salvage specimens, of course, aren't ideal. Something's happened to them, and then later they're found, picked up, so they haven't been, like, gotten into a refrigerated situation right away. The average bird, if you get it fresh enough, you can clean that skin, and you freeze it initially, but you clean that skin. The Cooper sock you're passing around out there, I did for a demonstration about, 2 years ago originally, and I've kept it in the freezer. And every time I want to show it around or I need something, I pull it out of the freezer, let it thaw. That's also why if some of you smell a little bit, it's not the Cooper sock. It's the odor, unfortunately, from the freezer I'm storing it in. Okay? So the Cooper sock itself doesn't smell bad, but it's picked up this odor from the freezer, unfortunately. So before I finally finish that bird, I will actually take that bird and dunk it in water, and Alice has worked with me doing this, take that bird, dunk it in water, get it soft again, and I'll position it into the final position, do the final detailing, and it'll be ready to go in. But because it's so clean, it does very well that way. Now, I would not keep it damp without keeping it refrigerated more than a couple of days, because then even though it's a super clean skin, now tan skins, they last for a really long time if you store them properly, once again, refrigerated. We've regularly worked on things. I work on things that I've had at the museum 20, 30 years, and I'm doing them. But when I'm actually finally working that skin, even something big, I'm going to want to work it over a period of, meaning putting it on the form, I'm going to want to work it over a period of a few days to a couple of weeks. Because even as a tan skin, if I keep it wet too long, the chance of mold or whatever. But they're fairly durable. Some things, like a hummingbird, surprisingly enough, is a fairly tough skin, but it's so tiny that if you don't get it mounted and set up in a couple hours, it's going to be dry. Something like this Cooper's Hawk is, you know, much more durable. That's why I brought it along today, so we could pass along. Actually, if I had been thinking about it, I would have brought a close relative of this Cooper Hawk. Is parrots, okay? Parrots, falcons, that group, believe it or not, if we look at their molt patterns, it's exactly the same. They're the only birds that have that same molt pattern. That means probably back in the back, they have a similar ancestor, and yet they're nowadays we look at them completely differently. But parrots, falcons, actually relatives back in time.
Another question?
We'll take the next one right here.
Hi. So what advice would you have for someone who's interested in starting taxidermy?
What advice for someone interested? Okay, I'm answering it. So yeah, if you're interested in starting taxidermy, first off, I would say for me, I had the wonderful benefit of learning. It's a very hands-on learning process. Even in taxidermy school, you know, and I only went for like a two-week program in Montana, you know, it was very like, okay, this step, kind of learning that way, and you're learning from someone. Most of the knowledge I use today, I mean, I've learned over the years of working with Tim, and I mean, that is just amazing. And happily today, we have my business, Prey Taxidermy, and I've tricked Tim into coming and teaching classes there.
That's a horrible experience.
So Tim teaches there, and then I have myself, and then Jen, my studio manager, is here today. She's also a scientific illustrator and paleontologist. And then is Madison floating around here? That girl didn't show up today. She's probably at work. Someone has to be there. But yeah, we do classes and everything there, so that's a good place to start. But if you're more into, like, let me read about it first. Let me do this. Let me do that. Or if you're a real self-starter, which is totally, lots of people have learned this way, I recommend you go to taxidermy.net. There's a forum on there with tutorials and everything. But please, 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 I'm going to reiterate, make sure to keep legal. There's a lot of laws in this country about birds and mammals and all of that, and they're good. They're there for good reason. You know, it's, oh, I just found it dead. Why can't I have this hawk? Well, who's going to CSI that you found it dead? Like, who are you hiring for that job? So it's about that. So, but yeah, and if you go to my website, praytaxidermy.com, you go to the FAQ. I've actually put a bunch of links on there for people who are aspiring to do taxidermy. There's resources, books, websites. There's a lot of great information out there. It's really having a renaissance right now.
There is really a lot of information out there on the net, just like there is of everything today. When I was growing up, you know, it was books. Back in the 60s, I would read books and start, you know, trying to do what was in there. And some of the, but the thing I had to learn back then, just like you do, and most of you who spend any time on the net know this, well, there's a lot of really good information. Of course, there's a lot of bad information, too, and it all seems to, like, grow at the same level. So you have to sort of be able to figure that out a little bit, and sometimes that's hard, but there's a huge amount of information out there, and there's a lot of people out there who are interested, and Alice has given a resource as far as learning here in LA if you want to do a hands-on thing, but a lot of people just get something, but be careful, as Alice said, especially here in California, you can't just pick up a roadkill legally in California. Okay, I can because I'm a museum person, and I have a salvage permit, but
yeah,
you can't.
I have been, when I worked for the museum, I did pick up some roadkill for us, and I was stopped by the cops and had to show them my museum badge, and they're still very confused, but let me on my way. I'm good at talking. It was all right. But, yeah, and then the other thing is on those tutorials and stuff, a lot of people come to taxidermy from different backgrounds. You have people that are coming from, they were a hunter, and they really wanted to start mounting their own stuff. They learned that way. You have other people coming from an art background, sculptors. You have other people in taxidermy that are going on to doing sculptures and bronzes and things like that. But we learn from each other as well. We actually have a visiting taxidermist here from South Africa, Travis Devilliers. And if you go on my Instagram, and actually I might pull up a quick photo, we're working on a mountain lion for Los Angeles County right now. And unfortunately, this guy was hit on the 5 freeway. He was very young mountain lion, off looking for, you know, probably his own territory, was unfortunately hit, but is now going to be utilized in education. And so here is a photograph of the sculpture of the, we're doing a, it's going to be a full body mount, but we really wanted to focus on the head. And so Travis has custom sculpted, you know, the whole face for us. And so this is his sculpture. I think he's changed a couple of things. That eye is now smaller. And that little thing over the lid is just set there because we actually tuck clay up into those lids. But you can kind of see, again, the glass eye. We use what's called an ear liner in the ear. So Travis is really, he's a taxidermist, but he's a sculptor. So that's a way that I haven't really worked in this way before. You know, seeing someone sculpt a whole new thing we're going to mold up. So we really learn from each other and share information because it's a small industry and we're all generally pretty spread out. And so the more we can pull the industry up, the better work out there. It makes us all look better and a little less like Norman Bates.
That's when you look at that, most people can tell, well, there's sculpting involved with taxidermy. But the problem is once we put a skin on that, most people look at it as a stuffed animal. And the reality is, especially with mammals, that unless you have a realistic sculpture under that skin, there's no way that that animal will look realistic. It will not. And so some of the best taxidermists I knew from way back in the 70s when I was competing and stuff, some of them quit taxidermy and they're bronze sculptors and they sell bronzes because they're accepted as artists then. Whereas once we put that is a beautiful rendition of a young mountain lion, and we put the skin on it, and it's going to look really good. But for the average person, they won't realize what went into producing that, and there's a high degree of skill and knowledge that Travis has that went into producing that, so that lion's really going to look nice.
All right. Do you have time for another?
We do, yeah. Where was the next question? Was it around here? I think this one.
I know when I go past a skunk that's hit on the road, it still smells. How do you deal with a skunk when you're going to mount it?
Yes. Well, luckily for me, that first skunk...
he usually gives them to someone like me.
That first skunk, yeah, I didn't have anybody. Like, I did learn very quickly that odor could be a problem. With that particular skunk, it was hit and killed without spraying. So it really wasn't bad. A few weeks later, I came across another one, and everybody in the neighborhood for like 3 blocks around, I think, knew I was working on a skunk until I didn't know a quick way to deodorize them. Now I do. There is, back in the 70s, I was doing some control work on animals, and so I dealt with a lot of skunks, and there was a little jar of something that was available at Savon Drugstore called CD, and that thing, that stuff, a couple of drops, their advertising was a couple of drops would neutralize a skunk, and it does. I have a bottle that I have from way back then, because I don't think they've been selling it for years. There's all kinds of things you can get in a pet shop, but I take that skin it off very carefully, especially around the gland area. You may not be aware of this, but the whole weasel family, most of the cat family, the dog family, they all have very pungent scent glands. You want to stay away from those when you're skinning. And then as soon as I got that skin off, I'd slop it into a solution with this soap and some CD. Scent gone. Now, if you put your nose right down in it after when it's damp, you get a little bit of that skunk smell, but you can kill it like that. So there's products now out there that take care of that problem. But sometimes I've had people working for me as volunteers, and I've said, whatever you do, don't hit the scent gland. And then pretty soon I hear, and I'm like, oh, you know. especially when you think about it, I've got some stuff that's regularly I work on stuff that's been in freezers 10, 15, 20 years. oh, that scent gland's dried out and it's gotten even stronger through time. So, yeah, there's a reason. And they, you know, they use that for territorial marking. All the cats do. The dog family does it. The weasel family does it. Most of the weasel family, a lot of weasels, like the local long-tailed weasel, actually, I think it smells much worse than a skunk. Skunk smells actually kind of sweet by comparison.
Yeah, you didn't warn me about that long-tailed weasel. Yeah. And they're sitting there skidding it, and I'm like, this is bad. Oh, yeah, you want to not hit the scent glands on the long-tailed weasels. Thanks, Tim. Great.
Well, there's knowledge. Certain knowledge is best learned.
Yes,
not
I guess.
Told.
I never forgot again. Any other questions?
Yeah, we'll take this one last question here.
Yeah, I was just going to say the sculptures are really beautiful. And I'm just wondering, do you ever display them without the skin? Because with the skin and fur, sometimes you can't see the form as well. I didn't realize how much went into that underneath. So do you ever display that at the museum with just the form?
I mean, not really. I mean, I have seen some museum exhibits where you can really see the musculature. The gentleman who does, I mean, the only real thing that's kind of showing that is the Body Worlds exhibit is kind of doing those, you know, they're doing animals and things now. I have seen some exhibits like, oh, this is how taxidermy's done. But typically speaking, work of like this and all that, I don't know if they've really found a place for it in that world. I mean, I think, again, people are starting to see taxidermy as this art. And hopefully part of that will be seeing anatomical sculpture as both art and education, which is, I think, really a part of the program here at Gnomon.
One of the things that's really important as far as the process, like, is I have huge numbers of photos, of sketches, of course, reference measurements, of carcasses of all kinds of animals. That's not out there anywhere. You can find pretty good reference of human reference for human anatomy and muscle studies and things like that. You can't find them for a lot of, most of the animals I work on. Some of the fairly common stuff that is popular, yeah, there's some stuff out there that's pretty nice, good anatomical. Jonathan Kingdom did a pretty nice selection of things of African animals. But by and large, it's not there. And so it's something, that's what makes it really hard, I think, for people to translate something that's under the skin to out of the skin, and you don't generally see that. And of course, the Body Works exhibit, I was disappointed by that because it was jerky, right? Those muscles were all shriveled up and dried up, so that really didn't see like you saw on that tiger, right? One of the great things to me is, and we probably had 100 people at the museum, at least staff, come by.
Yeah.
While I said, I just told a couple of people, hey, we're skinning the tiger today if you want to come by. Probably 100 staff members came by that didn't have any experience with seeing that kind of thing. And the thing immediately was, it wasn't the gross aspect of it, because it's not all bloody and stuff, was, wow, you can see that musculature. That's what's so valuable about having that animal, the carcass of that bird or whatever. You can look at that and really see what's going on, what makes that animal what it is, and then you have to try and translate that, of course, into your artificial body. But there's no, I mean, I have hundreds of carcass casts I made over the years that help me with that when I'm going to the sculpture. But you don't see those. There's not like a place where, you know, we show that kind of thing. We do it a little ways sometimes to talk about an exhibit and process. In our bird hall, we've got a giant illustration done by Mike Meeker, who was an artist, of a red tail with feathers on it. Carcass of a red tail in flight, showing all the muscles, and then the skeleton. And I actually, when he was going to do that, I said, you know, Mike, I can do a skeleton for you, I can have a skinned carcass for you, and I can have a bird that you can move, and you can go into the freezer and get them anytime. He was like, wow, Tim, that's like amazing. So he had the real thing to work with, but mostly, of course, you don't see that, right? It'd be a valuable thing. But the trouble is, like us in a museum, we have 35 million objects in our collection. So what do we show you? We have to really narrow down because we can't show you everything. There's not enough space. And so we have to be very, so to do a full, like for a while I had an exhibit showing the process, taxidermy, the skeleton, the sculpture, the mold, the final mount, took up too much room.
All right.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Let's have another round of applause, everyone.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. So we'll take a break now. There's a food truck in the park, the north parking lot, I believe. So you can go grab some snacks.
Well, I'm going to have to dip these dried out.
If anyone would like to see the birds in more detail, we'll have Molly, we'll have some of the other birds out now. Mark, can you turn their mics off? And if anyone wants a campus tour as well, please let us know and we can show you around either during the intermission or after the event this afternoon. And please make sure you come back for the second part with the ZBrush demonstrations with Crystal and Jared Morantz.